Good evening and welcome to our regular board meeting. For those of you who weren't here at the beginning of the meeting, we just started our meeting at 5 o'clock, just returned from closed session. To report during closed session, during the beginning of our meeting, Mr. Calderon Jr. Was not here but did arrive at closed session at 5:20 p.m. Other than that, reportable from closed session, Superintendent Ambriz.
There was no action taken in closed session, but there are two items that you're going to vote on out here.
Correct.
So in the student discipline case of M5 and M7. So with regards to case number 141512, the board was going to act on suspending the expulsion. Is there a motion for that?
Correct. So the motion would read as such: there is a recommendation to suspend the expulsion. Have student 141512 attend Aurora High School for semester plus one.
And accept the
rest of the recommendations. That is the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye. Motioned. Motion by myself. There's a second by trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are trustee Calderon Jr., trustee Calderon, trustee Ortega, and myself.
And so in the case of 141514, I believe that
the motion would read to accept the recommendation of the panel. That would be my motion. Is there a second?
Second.
The second by trustee Ortega. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are trustee Calderon Jr., trustee Calderon, trustee Ortega, and myself. That is all for now. We have to report on closed session, and we will reconvene to closed session following several different items on our agenda. Yes.
One more item to report.
Point of clarification, okay. Madam President. There was action taken on item D4 in closed session.
Okay.
By a vote of 3-0 with members Calderon Jr. and Ortega, with member Zuno absent from the vote, the board took action to direct legal counsel, myself, Salvador Holguin, and Mr. Ortega to coordinate schedules and issue notices to the appellant regarding an appeal meeting and the appeal procedures to be followed.
Thank you. Duly noted. At this time, we're going to take, if you're following along the agenda, we are on item G, comments from the public. The board will take any and all comments from the public related to an item on the agenda or any other item of district business that is not on the agenda. I'm going to go in order. These were received. We have Mr. James Taylor speaking on agenda item H2.
Good evening. Item H2 is the approval of minutes from the special board meeting of June 11, 2015. If you could pull can you pull the minutes up for that meeting? Because there's a summary of what I said at that meeting, and I would like it changed because it reflects the opposite of actually what I said. So if you scroll, it's the first thing on there, pretty right there. Okay, so in that second in the last paragraph on the page there, it says that I said that there are two teachers whose resignation letters are up for approval tonight, and that I urged you to consider the acceptance, but I actually urged you to reconsider the acceptance of those resignation letters. So if you could just add the letters RE to consider, that would be what I actually said. Okay, that was all.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor, and when we get to that item, we will more than likely motion to approve it with those changes. We have Alejo Cortez speaking on representing CSEA chapter 399.
Good evening, board members, administrators, teachers, classified employees, and parents. My name is Alejo Cortez, and I've been employed for Calexico Unified School District for 17 years as a custodian. I'm also part of the executive board for CSCA as a communication officer. I'm here to address the recent custodial transfers that happened on June 15th. You know, as you are aware, custodians were moved, and I see this as a safety issue because there's just, I lost track of my notes, sorry. You know, I see this as a safety issue concern because I was given no map of the school. I was given no alarm codes of the school. I was just given a set of keys, and there you go, go to work. You know, I was transferred to Cesar Chavez Elementary School, and before that, I worked at Blanche Charles. And as you know, the recent event and the recent incident at Blanche Charles that happened with the result of a death of a student, I was there. I was a part of it. So I see that as a concern because I know what to do at that school. I knew what to do at that school because I was there, and now I'm at this new school. Principal is not there. Site secretaries are also out on vacation, and we have summer school at that school. So in a case of emergency, what do we do? If that isn't enough concern for this district, you know, then what is? You know, these are our kids, these are our students that go to these schools. You know, something should have been done and addressed before these movements took place. And that's all I have to say about that.
Thank you, Mr. Cortez.
Thank you.
Ms. Susana Roy Tapia. Okay. Ms. Adria Lopez, speaking on towards the anti-discrimination resolution.
Good evening, honorable board members, administrators, and public. Today, I would like to point out a few concerns regarding the proposed resolution. First of all, I would like to say that I'm sure all of us present are for anti-discrimination, but that this, who isn't, right? But this particular document leaves much to the discretion of whoever is going to be claiming to be discriminated. And that this is what I would like for the board to be questioning. I did send an email to the board with some points that I would like to read. I would question the need to approve this resolution. First of all, because this same resolution has been already approved at the county level. On April 13, it's resolution number 041315-7. Therefore, I see this is repetitive, redundant, and unnecessary for our district. Since this document already reads that every school district in this county is to adopt policy regarding anti-discrimination. Anti-discrimination laws and policies are already in place at the federal, state, county, and school district level. If someone chooses not to follow them, they are already subject to specific consequences. I would also ask that if you are considering adopting this resolution, there needs to be certain things listed specifically for it to be considered. There are open-ended terminology included here that would leave a door open for possible future demands against the district or staff or parents or students that the district would be dealing with if these are not things that are plainly worded, such as when it states that the district seeks to empower people who experience discrimination based on what we all know and the terminology we all know already. It's not saying who will be empowering our students or whoever feels discriminated. So I think it's very important to see who we're going to be opening our doors to. As to proponents of LGBTQ movements, definitely are looking for subtle ways to introduce biased information to our students. I also want to point out that it mentions that the proposed resolution also includes language such as not to be targeted with personal hate. Regarding personal hate, who is to say what is personal hate? This needs to be outlined so it does not convert in something subjective. What you might feel is hate, I might not feel it's hate. Who is to say what is hate? And this opens the door to emotional points of view, and it does not clarify to what extent this will be taken into effect. Is thinking, give me one second.
Ms. Lopez, while you continue, I'll just remind you of the time.
Okay, I'm almost done, I'm sorry. Is openly dissenting with a certain lifestyle going to be considered as personal hate? I think we live in a wonderful country, and we are part of a wonderful country where lots of people from lots of countries come because of freedom, the freedom it has to offer to its citizens. And I think we should not be limiting that freedom of thought. And by accepting this type of open-ended resolutions, documentation that binds the district to go by, we open the door to things that will not be clear and will be causing further problems to the district instead of solving. I do want to point out also that our district already has anti-discrimination policy in place, and I'm very proud of that. And I think our district already complies with the resolution that was put forth by the Imperial County Office of Education. I ask you to take this matter not lightly, but to please make sure that your decision is specifically informed so you can make the best choice for our students. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Lopez. If there's anybody else that would like to make public comments at this time, otherwise that is all I have in terms of what was brought before us. Seeing none, we're going to move on to item H, our consent agenda. Is there a motion? And I'll remind the board that there is a request on item H2 by Mr. James Taylor to modify the minutes of special board meeting of June 11th, and he stated what those changes were. Ms. Burgos has made note of those, so the motion should would include the approval of the minutes of item H, particularly item H2, with those changes.
Motion to approve.
Would this be the entire consent agenda?
Yes, the entire, with the exception of those corrections.
Thank you. So there is a motion by Trustee Calderon Jr. to approve the consent agenda with the correction on item H2 as duly noted by, recorded by Ms. Burgos. There's a second by Trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. We are on item I, action and informational items. We have item number one, our superintendent's report.
I am going to not have a report for the board tonight, given the length of our agenda and how the delay of our meeting continuing. The only thing that I will update the board on is where we are with our Bulldog Aquatic Center. And we have the pre-bid conference that took place on June 18th. The deadline to submit proposals for contractors on the pool is July the 2nd. There should be a recommendation for pool contractors submitted to the board on July the 9th. And if all goes well, on July 15th, construction should actually start. Or in the end of July, construction should start. And construction should end next summer. And that is all I have right now, and so we can continue with the agenda.
Thank you, Superintendent. We're going to take our association. I'm sorry, there's a booster. Is there a booster meeting update? Item 1A?
I'll be brief.
Thank you. I almost skipped right through you.
Good evening, trustees. I just wanted to update the board on the status of our booster meetings. Back earlier this year, I believe in March, I had done a presentation regarding the procedures for the booster club, and the board did ask that I start meeting with the community and get their input on those procedures and those things. So that's been happening. We had our first booster meeting on April the 29th, where it was very well attended. It included members of the community, the athletic director, and other sports coaches. So it was actually a very well attended, great meeting where we provided information. We went over the packets. We went over the procedures as to how to become a booster. And then we had a follow-up meeting on June the 16th, where we went further into discussion. The community members that attended, they were provided with information as far as, again, the application packet, how to get started as a booster. We provided them with information on obtaining insurance and all of those things that are required in the booster. And things are really rolling very well. We're going to schedule a meeting over the summer where we'll invite the coaches, and again with the community members that are interested in forming a booster, to give them a work session and give them some working time here in the boardroom so that they can work on their bylaws and all of those different things that as a part of their packet to become a booster. And then we, at the beginning or when school is going to start, we're going to bring those applications back to the board and let the board approve boosters for the 15-16 school year. So that was just my update for the Booster Club.
Thank you, and thank you for putting all of that together.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
Now we're on item I2, association comments. Do we have ACT, Mr. Taylor?
Good evening, board members, district administration, classified staff, teachers, members of the public. It's great to be up here tonight because I have a lot of positive things to report on. First, I want to say that ACT, the teachers and counselors and school psychologists and school nurse and everybody kind of under that umbrella of ACT would like to extend a big thank you and a lot of appreciation to the administration and staff at Calexico Unified School District because they made something pretty amazing happen. As everybody in here knows, we came to our contract agreement, and as a result, teachers are going to be paid an additional 6% for the 2014-2015 school year. And there was a concern that possibly that wouldn't happen until the middle of July. And if that had been the case, then we would have been taxed a lot, like 52%. But because of the work of the district, it looks like we're going to get that retro pay on June 30th, which is fantastic. And I can tell you every single teacher is really happy about that. So that is excellent news, and really a sincere and heartfelt thank you to everybody who helped with that, because it is very much appreciated.
And Mr. Taylor, the business department, the ladies really worked, well, Mrs. Redona, the midnight oil type work.
You know, I'll tell you, when it came up after negotiations were finished, it was looked at as an impossibility. So you made something impossible possible, so thank you very much for the work that went into that. So big round of applause to everybody involved. Yeah, definitely something. I'm going to keep going with the positive stuff because I do have a couple of other things. But anyway, this coming week, five teachers from Calexico Unified School District, including myself, will be taking part in the National Educators Association Representative Assembly, which is happening in Orlando, Florida. Six teachers from Imperial Valley were elected to be part of this. Five of those six are coming from Calexico. So, yeah, which is great. And that says a lot. And so just to give you a little bit of background, there are 3 million members of the NEA, the National Educators Association. And the NEA helps shape federal policy on education by making recommendations to the federal government. And so that five out of the six Imperial County teachers having any kind of say in that kind of policy change, that we're coming from Calexico, is fantastic news for our district. Now on to a couple of things well, the first thing is the LCAP. And overall, again, I do think that the LCAP plan is, this year's LCAP plan is a huge improvement over what we had before. And so, you know, I don't want that to not be said. But that being said, I was a little bit alarmed when I looked at the LCAP plan that is being proposed for tonight, because it does differ from the plan that was given at the public hearing at the last board meeting. And one of the main differences there are some good differences. I mean, I see the budgetary items are being they're being worked out, like the figures and everything, but something was deleted, and it was a little alarming to me because it was something that more than just teachers were recommending. And so I don't want to misquote it, so I'm just going to pull it up really quick. Item number 7 on the old plan, under goal 8, which is for our English learners, said that in collaboration with human resources, there would be a plan to develop and implement the recruitment and retention of teachers. That was deleted. And I don't know why it was deleted. I don't think anybody at the public hearing was asking for that to be deleted. So I'm not sure why it was deleted. So I'm hoping to find out why. But that's the only big thing that I would have to say, negatively about that plan. But I do know that LCAP plan is something that can be continually revised, and I would hope that finds its way back in there somehow. Because again, I don't think any of those stakeholder groups were really calling for that to be deleted. That being said, we had this LCAP core committee, and we met 4 times, I believe, near the end of the school year, and those meetings went great. You know, we had stakeholder members from the teacher group, the parent group, administrators, classified, and students all meeting together and making recommendations, and most of those recommendations made it in the plan, which is fantastic. I would just love to see that group continue to meet, and to meet earlier than the last month of the school year. So I'm hoping that next year, that LCAP group meets starting in September, because then we have time to really get into it, basically. And finally, and I had no idea I was going to talk about this tonight, but we, in the public comments, we did have somebody come up here and criticize the human rights issue that is coming before the board tonight. And I, as a member of not only ACT, but CTA, it's my responsibility to stand up for the human rights of our students. And, on the top of the list of human rights is that people are treated with equality. So the idea that you should be afraid of approving a human rights policy or some kind of resolution because it makes everybody equal under it is kind of ridiculous, if you ask me. So, you know, I mean, everybody's entitled to their opinion, sure, but somebody's opinion should not infringe on the human rights of another person. So I just want to say that in support of all of our students who all deserve human rights and should all be, you know, seen as equal by everybody in the district. So with that being said, that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. CSEA, Ms. Rolona.
Good evening, board members and public. Sonia Redona, CSCA president. I don't know if you're aware that the custodians were changed school sites. Okay, when you apply for a job here in Calexico, it tells you what school site you'll be working at. Well, on April 27, 2015, because of one custodian that got in trouble, they decided to change all the custodians. But not all of them, just some, which I think it's not fair, okay? We haven't had any problems, any issue with any of the custodians. So I have asked administration, supervisor, what benefit does the district get by changing these custodians? The custodians are the first ones in line when the students come in. They know the teacher, they know the school. They become friends to our students where the students like to talk to them, okay? So by doing this move, these custodians were just handed keys. Here, go to your new school site. Do they know where the safety is? Do they know the plan in case of emergency? Do they know where to shut the gas valves, the water? What is the plan in case of an earthquake? I believe maybe some of those principals haven't even been notified about this change. Now, before, custodians were able to transfer from school to school. It's not allowed anymore. Why? I want a good reason. Because you're not going to benefit anybody. The staff, the custodians know when there's something the teachers need. They know where to get the equipment. They talk to the parents on a daily basis. Students, staff. It's a totally new ball game for the custodians. And my answer and my question is, what benefit do we get by changing these custodians? Most of these custodians have been there for 5 to 15 years. They know the students very well. They know the parents. Parents talk to them, ask them concerns about the students. It's totally a new ball game again. I urge you, please put them back where they belong. Just for an example, I was there the second day, what happened at Blanche Charles. The custodian was not on duty, but he sure did run fast enough to open those gates so the ambulance could go in. They have not been trained what to do at those school sites. This is a bad change. It's causing more problems with us, with the custodians. The other day I heard the principal told one of the custodians, I need you to go get me the go-kart. Well, I don't know where it's at. They were just put in those schools without orientation and telling what they have to clean, where's the safety issues, nothing. I urge you, please return them back to where they belong. They've been there. I had no problems, no complaints from any. Why was the change done? Give me a good reason. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Redona. Item I3, the pool report, I believe we received an update from...
The only thing I would add to that is that we did receive confirmation this week that I forgot to share earlier. We did receive confirmation this week from the Department of State Architects that the project plans have been certified and approved by the Department of State Architecture.
That is true, and thank you for that update. We're going to move on to our board reports. Item I4, my left, your right. I'll start with Mr. Calderon Jr.
I'll be short. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here tonight. I know the weather's up there a little muggy, but you're here. Thanks a lot. I only have one question, and it's ironic that I have this question. I've been asking for a safety plan of this district-wide safety plan from who's going to open up the gate when we have an ambulance coming to who's going to go get that golf cart and so forth. And I just need to know when this safety plan is going to be coordinated so we can get our schools ready for this coming year.
Okay, thank you.
Can we have a date? Because this is probably the, if not the third, probably the second time I asked for this plan.
Yes, our district administrative team is meeting mid-July to prepare for all of the things that we need to do for next year, and at the top of our list is the safety plan, so that we know how to coordinate it with our different principals, especially now that there has not just been a movement in terms of classified staff, such as the custodians, but also administrative moves, so that the new principals and assistant principals are also aware of the safety plans and issues at each site. So you will have a follow-up before, probably by the last meeting in July, you'll have a follow-up, a more official follow-up on that.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Mr. Calderon.
I'll be quick. Well, not that quick, but I'll be quick given the
I don't think your mic is on. Will you check your mic?
It is. It is on. Hello. So we went to the NALEO conference, which is the national conference for Hispanic elected officials. And I believe that we got something back from that. That was very important, which is we learned some of the laws that apply only to California and not to other states. There were some laws that I didn't know. I personally hadn't engaged in those practices, but there are some laws that we need to be careful. Here in California, it doesn't apply for other states. So I was glad to see that we were able to hear a lot of legal commentators regarding issues regarding that had to do with not only education but city and state issues. So it was interesting. I went to Cesar Chavez right before I left for that conference for summer school. A very well organized in my opinion. I visited a lot of schools, and I've been in a lot of schools, so it was run very well. I went to Mainz today, and the same thing. Everything was it was working as it's supposed to be working, so I'm glad that the summer school is working as it's supposed to be working. However, I did see a Mainz that we still have those. We only have 3 reserved parking spots for parents, and we have 20 parking spots for everybody else. So I think I would like to discuss that with the superintendent later, because we need to make sure that our parents are well taken care of, or visitors, and not just given 15 minutes to park there. So that was, I parked there and I was there for like 30 minutes. But overall, the visits that I did, it was a nice experience. So thank you.
Thank you. Trustee Ortega?
Yeah, well, I'll be short as well. I was also fortunate enough to attend the conference for NALEO this past week. You know, it was very interesting. You know, it made us, I think, more informed and more effective policymakers, given the sessions that we attended, you know, on ethical decision-making for policymakers, strategic planning, and moving our policies forward. And of course, you know, one of them was preserving and supporting the qualified teacher workforce. You know, as everybody's aware, you know, there is a educator workforce shortage throughout the nation. So it gives us something to bring back to the community so we can be better board members. So that's very important. And thank you. That's it.
Thank you. I too went to the NALEO conference with Mr. Calderon and Mr. Ortega, and everything they said, I concur with everything. We did bring back a lot of information that as a board, I think is going to help us. And one of the things that we discussed while you're there, and it's interesting as we sit here, and all of you go out to trainings and conferences, and I know sometimes we kind of badger you a little bit that you get to go everywhere. But one of the things that I think it does and it did for us is it helps build camaraderie. And I think that the people that benefit from that, not only ourselves, but are you, those who we serve, our students. It serves them the most if we are collegial with one another. If we're all in the same workshop, listening to the same information, and then you leave and you talk about it and you're deciphering it and you kind of put it together, you piece it together. So I'm excited with the momentum that I think that you bring back when you get to go to these things. So I'm grateful for the opportunity. And my last comment is going back to the safety. I think Mr. Calderon, you call it a safety plan, and Ms. Ambriz, you said you're going to get together in pretty soon to discuss that. I know for the last, I'm going to think maybe 3 years since I've been on the board. I think maybe both ACT, CSEA, if I'm not mistaken, has been asking to be part of a safety committee. They've been requesting a safety committee. I'd like to see that everyone is engaged in how to put this together. I'd like to see a work group so that everyone has a voice in how we come up with this plan. That's all I have for my comments. Item I-5, we have a career technical education meeting notes or minutes.
Yes, and we have Mr. Phil Villamore from IVROP who wanted a few minutes of the board's time to share some important information regarding some meetings that have taken place, and he'd like to apprise the board of the minutes of such meetings that are in regards to the different pathways that our students have access to here in Calexico Unified and throughout the county as well.
That's Mr. correct.
Yeah, so the meeting notes should be part of whatever you've got in your packets is my belief. And if you've looked at those, they're extensive, so trust me, I'm not going to be going over every piece of those notes. You can rest assured. However, it is to give some perspective to those notes, as Ms. Ambriz was saying. The reason you're receiving those is that those meetings, that those notes documents, are part of state and federal regulations that the schools must follow. IVROP is part of that for you. So when you're looking at the industry sector advisory notes that specifically indicate that they're from IVROP, what you have received are the notes that are particular to the pathways that Calexico Unified School District offers. Again, which is fits into the discussion that you were having briefly about professional development, either as a board or for your instructors. Probably one of the least expensive forms of professional development that you can offer your instructors, and one of the most beneficial. So the fact that we have these meetings is a mandate. So if you offer health science or if you offer an auto pathway, the idea is those things change. There's new information all the time that industry can be providing to your teachers, and that's what those meetings are about. So we have those meetings. We ask, what are the latest trends? Are the things that we're doing in our classrooms the things that we should be doing? And we get that kind of input. So just for, as a, again, an FYI for your information, teachers, administrators, and counselors are invited to those. You'll see those folks within the minutes, and that's part of what we would point out as being important. There are also notes that are titled a CTE annual advisory meeting or a CTE advisory meeting that is specific to Calexico in there. And those, again, are very similar. They are the reason you have that mandate is because you're going to be putting Perkins funds in that case towards those pathways at your high school. And it's going to have similar information at that meeting, but that meeting is usually informed by the other meetings that IVROP put on throughout the year, either by them looking at those notes again or by your instructors who would have had part in those meetings bringing that information to bear. So again, the overall purpose being giving purpose to what the classes are offering, making sure that it is relevant, and discussing things, everything from are the skills that we're teaching relevant to does this class articulate at the college level? Does it get credit over at the community college? Again, briefly, that would be my report on the notes you have. Clearly, all of those notes contain much more than I just said, but it's for you to digest with that in mind. If there's any questions, I'll take them. Other than that.
Are there any questions from the board? No, but thank you for your report, and thank you for sharing this with us. And
thank you.
And just in addition to all of that, you know, Mr. Villamore has been working closely with our district and with our high school and Mrs. Montaño here at the district office with regards to our CTE program. And so I know that we're going to have another item on one of our future agendas with regards to an MOU with the continued services. So you'll be seeing another item regarding IVROP and CTE and our pathways in the near future.
Good.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. Correct me if I'm wrong, this was informational only. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Item I-6, the accounts payable pre-list. Are there questions or is there a motion? No, we just, it's informational only, I'm sorry. Yeah. Are there questions on this? Okay, if none. Item I-7, the approval of the first reading of the revised administrative regulations 4112.4, 4212.4, 4312.4, health examinations.
Okay, and this item is being brought to you by our HR department.
Thank you, Ms. Rosales.
Regarding the TB and other.
Good evening, trustees. We bring this one to you as a first reading. Now, we currently have administrative regulation for health examinations. This one specifically is for tuberculosis testing. And so, just to give a little bit more information, there was Assembly Bill number 1667 that was passed in September 15, 2014. And it became law January 1st, 2015. And so what this is an update to the administrative regulation, and this is all ed code. It's coming directly from the California School Board Association, which is the GAMET. And so we're bringing it to you for a first reading. Again, it does exist, but what this will do is keep us in compliance with ed code.
Thank you, Mr. Gonzalez. Are there any questions from the board? I'm seeing none. Is there a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Thank you. There's a motion to approve item I-7, the approval of the first reading of the revised administrative regulations. By Trustee Calderon, and there's a second by Trustee Calderon Jr. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Is Mr. Gutierrez in here?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I just received this a request to speak on item, on the item that's coming up. So Mr. Gutierrez will take your comment now before we deliberate.
Yeah, Roberto Gutierrez, a retired counselor and presently substitute teaching here with the district. I was informed that the Imperial County Office of Education, the board had passed a resolution for anti-discrimination for the whole county. And then somebody informed me that they wanted the same thing to also be passed with the school district. And they told me that if the county is doing it and they gave directives to the school district, that it didn't have to be done specifically for each district because it's already become like policy. I have, let's say, a couple of experiences, not experiences, but information, what happens if you over-regulate. For instance, or when people, well, you empower them, you empower them to not be discriminated. But recently in San Antonio, the mayor, who is gay, asked that all the pastors in San Antonio, that their sermons have to be turned over to the mayor, to the city. So it caused a big uproar. A lot of people maybe didn't hear about it. Okay, so people started coming and in getting information and voicing their opinion, and she had to backtrack. Okay, in Canada, a pastor, his sermon on Romans 1, what God talks about relationships between man and man and woman to woman. So pastors can be put in jail, and it's called hate crime in Canada. I don't know if you're aware of that. Okay. Now, in England, a man had a hostel, his hotel, it's in. He had a gentleman, Arab, and happened to be Muslim, because there's, you know, Christianism came first, and the Arabs were first Christian and other things before they were Muslim. Muslims came around in 600. So he was in England, and this person who rented for the night, he started talking to the owner of the hostel. And they started talking about Christians and talking about Mohammed, Muslim, etc. Well, a couple of following days, they called the owner of the hostel, the city attorney or whatever, and they fined him because whatever he said was offensive. I mean, they were just talking. So it was like a hate crime. A couple, also, there's another incident in England where this older...
Mr. Gutierrez, I'll just point out that your 3 minutes are okay. Covering.
This older gentleman was just out there protesting what it says in Romans, and a couple of kids beat him up. And the police came, and you know what? They arrested the old man and not the kids. So we have to be careful.
Thank you, Mr. Gutierrez.
Thank you.
Okay, I need to call for a short recess right now, and we just need to confer briefly. I apologize for the interruption. But call for a recess.
Good.
Welcome back, and thank you for bearing with us during our impromptu recess. And I will alert everyone here. If you picked up a hard copy of tonight's board meetings, you may have noticed that they don't particularly jive with the electronic version. And we have since corrected that, and there was only one item. If you look at, what was there earlier under what should have been item I-12 was not on there. So what we had electronically was not what was there, but we have reprinted corrected versions, and so now I-12 is the discussion of the board trustee vacancy, and that is what was different from the first copies that were put out there in the meeting. But what you all received electronically days ago and what was posted on the website is accurate. It was just a printing error. So thank you. We are going to move on, and we left off on item I-8, trustees, the consideration of adopting resolution regarding anti-discrimination. I motion to approve this resolution. Would there be a second? Seeing no second, this motion dies for a lack of second. Item I-9, the approval of resolution for fiscal year 2015-16 child development program contract and resolution for the state preschool program at Kennedy Gardens Elementary School. Ms. Montaño.
Good evening. Claudia Montaño, Director of Projects. This is a yearly contract that we have with the state of California. We are the only district in the county that actually runs a state preschool program, and this is the yearly contract for that program.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions?
Motion.
Is there a motion to approve? By Trustee Calderon Jr. Is there a second?
Second.
The second by Trustee Ortega. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Thank you, Ms. Montaño. Unanimously, those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-10, the approval of a memorandum of understanding between Calexico Unified School District and ICOE for AmeriCorps Project Borderlands Project. Program, you're right.
Motion to approve.
It's a motion
I'm good.
I'll second.
Sorry, there's a motion to approve item I-10 by Trustee Calderon Jr. and a second by Trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-11, the approval of a resolution certifying that HCD relocatable buildings are no longer being used for school purposes.
I do have one question.
Thank you, Mr. Nielsen.
Jeremy.
Yes, sir.
Are these buildings tagged, inform the public that they can't, we can't have students in them?
Yeah, we don't have any.
We don't?
No, the HCD relocatables are very distinct looking. They have the two doors. They're like job site trailers is what they look like. I've been to every campus and we don't have any of those in use, so. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Motion to approve.
Thank you. There's a motion to approve item I-11 by Trustee Calderon Jr. Is there a second?
I'll second.
A second by Trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-12 is the discussion of the vacancy that we have, the consideration and actions upon procedures to be followed to fill the vacant position on the board created by the resignation of Mr. Walter Kress.
So for this item, as we are all aware, Mr. Kress has resigned his post as board member officially effective June 11th of 2015. As a result, there is a vacancy, and at this time, our board needs to decide how it will fill that vacancy, with a couple of options being available to them, the first being possibly opting for a provisional appointment. If that were the case, this board seat would be viable and in effect until the next regular election, which is scheduled for November of 2016. And then, or go ahead and order an election for November of 2015. Failure to make a decision as to how to fill this position would result in our county superintendent ordering an election for this seat, and that election would be ordered for November of 2015. So an election, whether at our request or ordered by ICOE, would come in at an additional cost to the district. If a provisional appointment is the will of the board majority, then attached as part of the backup is the resolution declaring the board vacancy and how our district would proceed in filling this vacancy. So it really is up to the board to decide whether it's a provisional appointment or ordering a special election.
Mr. Ogin, if this has happened to us twice already, so I'm going to say it, unfortunately I was here for the first time that it happened. I don't know if it has happened in the history of Calexico before, but in my short tenure it has happened twice. So if we decided to leave it as it is at this point, can the county sue, like Maria said, just ordered it legally? Can he say that?
Under the Ed Code section, I believe it's 5091, the board has 60 days to order or to take action, either to have a special election or at the next election or to appoint. If you do nothing and leave it open, then the education code requires the county superintendent to order an election. There's no in-betweens. So the county superintendent shall order an election.
So, but you said that the next election, so I'm assuming that there will be an election in November?
Depending on the cycle, it would be in November. If it's an off year, county sup could order a special election even.
Okay.
So, but in this, under these circumstances, if you did nothing, the county superintendent would likely order it to come about in the cycle of November 15th, as opposed to a spring election in April or something of the sort.
Okay.
All right.
With that said, I move to appoint someone. We can't spend money on an election, so that is my...
Yeah, I will concur with Mr. Calderon regarding that. We can't really afford $50,000, roughly, right, Maria?
I really can't give you a figure, but I remember the last time it was in the ballpark of about 30 plus.
30. Maya already gave me the figure, just looking at me.
Maya, how much?
Yeah.
Say it.
And the clock already started, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Correct. It started notice. Effective June 11th, and I believe the official 60th day would be, if it's not August 9th, it's August 11th or something in that ballpark.
And that's when the county superintendent can call for a special election?
If we've taken no action whatsoever, he would likely call something shortly thereafter.
Okay.
Then, like I said, well, I will concur with Mr. Calderon regarding this. We have two options, and as much as I would like to keep this in a very democratic way, which will be having an election, this is just too much money. $30,000? Roughly.
Roughly.
Could be more. Why does it cost so much? No, I'm not kidding. No, I'm not. Why does it cost so much to have an election?
Ben, is that $30,000 on an off year, like when no other elections are being held? It'd probably be more expensive, right?
It might be more, and that's expensive, why I said I think the low end of it would be about the 30s. Mm-hmm. It might be more if there's nothing else going on.
So, trustees, we do have a motion to appoint. If you look at item number 4 on the second page of the resolution, it calls, it speaks towards board bylaw 9223 that a committee of 2 members of this board would be appointed tonight to ensure the applicants are eligible for board membership, and announces the name of eligible candidates. So it is asking that 2 board members appointed to that advisory committee be named today.
Where's that again?
Second page, item number 4. It's in the resolution.
Okay, so it would be part of the resolution.
It's part of the resolution. Okay. If you open up your documentation, it's the second page of that resolution.
Yeah. Item number 4 reads, in accordance with Board Bylaw 9223, a committee of 2 members of the board is appointed as an advisory committee within the meaning of Government Code Section 54952, Subdivision B, to ensure that applicants are eligible for board membership, and announces the names of eligible candidates. So the 2 board members appointed to that advisory committee are?
I would like to nominate Mr. Eric Ortega and Mr. Calderon Jr. on the premise that Mr. Calderon and I were on the previous advisory committee.
That's right. And
we've gone through the process.
Right. And as everybody knows, I'm familiar with the process as well. So
we called and very.
Madam President, since the drafting of the version that's available in the packet, I've taken the opportunity to review the resolution, and I've made a few suggested revisions as well. If I may just simply share with the board, and I don't know if Ms. Burgos prepared extra copies to share with the board of the revised resolution. Does the board have that?
I think we're all looking at an electronic version.
There's a hard copy version that has a draft watermark on it so that we could distinguish. And with regard to the changes that I've suggested, was just if you do adopt all the timelines, none of the timelines have changed. I've just added the word Thursday in front of most of the dates because the deadlines were Thursdays, and just to avoid any confusions for folks in the public who might have thought it was a Friday deadline, for submitting things, just to be clear that it would fall on a Thursday. I've made no other revisions, but if it seems the board's interest here is to proceed with an appointment process. So my suggestion is, if the board is going to have some revisions to this resolution, that we incorporate those as part of your motion, and either with authority to have the resolution approved subject to the revisions you've made as part of your motion.
Thank you. So trustees, if the motion is to proceed, the motion made by Trustee Calderon Jr., it would be to that the board approves the resolution, and then with the appointment, the assignment of the two board members that will serve on the advisory committee, and adopt the changes on the draft version that we're looking at that includes the word Thursday with some highlighted dates.
And Madam President, I also made some suggested revisions to other exhibits to this document. None necessarily substantively. If you look at Exhibit 1, Trustee Vacancy, again to set out some bolds. And as I'm looking at here, I just quickly spotted a parenthesis that's missing in the phone number following the area code 760. And deleting the dash there. With respect to the guidance to applicants, there was a substantive change, a couple substantive changes that were made there. In the first paragraph, I believe the original draft included former board member Kim's name. That was changed to Mr. Walter Kress there. And then there had been reference to the candidate holding this office following appointment only until the next election scheduled for the district's governing board members, which would be November 2016. So let me explain that a little bit to the board. The way your appointment works is not for the entire remainder of Mr. Kress's seat. It's only until the next election of board members for this board. There would be an election then to elect someone to this seat. So I know, Mr. Calderon, you had made a comment about the democratic process. There will be that opportunity in November of 2016.
Both of these drafts, they say until November 2018. This draft, it says that as well. It says applicants number two, applicants must be willing to give the needed time to this position and be willing to complete Mr. Kress's tenure up to November 2018.
It's supposed to read. I'm sorry, did you guys hear me?
2016.
Okay.
Right, but the version we have says 2018.
Correct.
Yes.
And that's why these are all drafts. Again, we could not anticipate the board's decision whether to go with an election or this, but this is a good time to catch this. So in item number two, that would be changing from 2018 to 2016.
Yes.
But assuming that the person would be reelected or elected, and they would only serve until November 2018. Mm-hmm. It would not go beyond that. Mm-hmm. Then it would return to its regular election cycle.
So this draft, then even the draft that we just printed, then it should be changed to November 2016.
Correct. And item number two.
Item number two, yes.
You'll see that reference in the second paragraph. The selected candidate will hold office vacated by Walter Kress until the next regularly scheduled election for district governing board members, November 2016.
Yes. So it needs to be changed, the bottom one.
Right, the number two would need to be changed. And then I believe all of the remainder of the information is the same as had been prepared by the former board when there was a vacancy arising following Mr. Kim's resignation.
Thank you. Thank you, and thank you for that clarification. And trustees, would you be in favor then of Trustee Ortega and Trustee Calderon Jr. For the advisory committee?
I will make that motion, or
well, it would be just direction. Be part of the original
direction
motion.
Okay.
Okay. So we would need a motion at this time that would include all of that. Somebody that remembers everything.
Motion to assign.
To it'd be position. To approve the resolution.
I'd like to approve the resolution that speaks to assigning a board member effective immediately, correct? Until
so there's a motion by Trustee Calderon Jr. to approve the resolution towards speaking towards the appointment of the vacancy created by the resignation of Trustee Walter Kress with the corrections towards dates, with the addition of the board trustees that will serve on the advisory committee.
I will second
with
that.
I'll be right there with some technical corrections on adding a parentheses on the exhibit one. And on the guidance to applicants in preparing their application, correct the date on item number two from November 2018 to November 2000 to reflect to 16. November 2016. Is that your motion? Thank you. That's a motion by Trustee Calderon Jr. Is there a second?
I will second that.
Second by Trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Thank you. Item I-13, the approval of extension of preventative maintenance and supply service agreements for district-wide copiers and printers for two additional years. Authorization to piggyback off California State University contract 70818 for new lease and replacements. Are there any questions on this item?
Yeah, I got a question. Are we saving any money? You don't have to get up.
Yes, we are.
We are? Mm-hmm. How much?
About $30,000.
Oh.
And there's a benefit in the fact that we'll get to get new printers. It's going to cover our service agreement for all of the new printers that we're getting for additional staff. They'll be able to be under our maintenance contract. And we're going to kind of standardize the printers throughout the district. So when we are having the ink and toner and that type of things, it'll be kind of standardized around the district. Mm-hmm. So there is a cost saving and the benefit of new equipment for our staff.
Okay. I motion to approve.
Thank you.
There's second.
There's a motion to approve item I-13 by Trustee Calderon Jr. And there's a second by Trustee Ortega. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-14 is the approval of the single plan for student achievements for the 2015-16 for the schools that are listed before you.
Are there any questions on this item? We have all schools except for dual school being represented in the list of SPSAs being approved. And that is due to the ongoing leave.
I have no question.
I move to approve.
Second.
There's a motion to approve by Trustee Calderon, a second by Trustee Calderon Jr. Thank you, Ms. Montaño. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-15, the approval of piggyback purchase of one refrigerated and two non-refrigerated food transport vehicles. Is there a motion or do we need more information?
I need some more information, Mr.
Venegas.
Yes, sir.
And I've asked this question before because we gave you almost $500,000 in new equipment. Was this not part of the...
It's part of the spending plan, sir.
It is?
Mm. Yes.
Okay, so that's gonna, it's in addition to the money that we gave you?
Yes, sir.
It is?
No, it's included in it.
Okay.
It's part of the 1.25.
Do we have now transportation vehicles that are refrigerated and so forth?
No, refrigerator vehicles at this time. But we do have three transport vehicles, one that's on standby that breaks down all the time, and two others that also break down.
Okay. So this is actually going to augment what you have now, and then we'll provide cold temperatures. All right. Okay. I don't know if you...
And it was budgeted, right, Ma?
Yes.
Okay. All right.
I'll motion to approve.
I'll second.
The motion to approve item I-15 by Trustee Calderon Jr., second by Trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-16, authorization to piggyback from Imperial County Schools bid for the purchase of copy paper and other instructional supplies for fiscal year 15-16.
I'll move to approve.
Second.
This is a motion to approve item I-16 by Trustee Calderon Jr., second by Trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-17, the approval of a memorandum of understanding between Calexico Unified School District and Imperial County Behavioral Health Services Youth for Young Adult Program school site.
I move to approve.
Second.
It's a motion to approve item I-17 by Trustee Calderon, a second by Trustee Calderon Jr. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-18, the approval of agreement between Calexico Unified School District and San Jose State University for the 15 through 2020 field training.
Maria, is this the first year that we do this with San Jose?
I'm not sure if it's the first year. Yes, it is.
It is, I haven't heard San Jose, so yeah, it's always, a good idea to do these kind of training. Yeah. So,
and I think we currently have one person who's interested in this, so.
I move to approve.
Second.
This motion to approve item I-18 by Trustee Calderon and a second by Trustee Calderon Jr. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-19, the approval of 2015 through 2016 food service agreement between Calexico Unified School District and ICOE Calexico Academy.
I move to approve.
Second.
It's a motion to approve by Trustee Calderon and a second by Trustee Calderon Jr. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-20, the approval of the local control and accountability plan for the school year 15-16.
And Dr. Estrada, as usual, this is a living document, which means that it can be modified, assuming that the results.
That is correct. It can be modified throughout the year. It's a living document.
Perfect. I move to approve.
And I have a question. Sorry. Towards Mr. Taylor's comment that something was deleted from that. Is that part of this being that sort of fluid process that things can get changed or?
Good evening again. I wanted to address Mr. Taylor's comment. I think it was a very valid comment, and I want to reassure Mr. Taylor and the board that it is the practice of the district to always recruit and retain highly qualified teachers. In the LCAP, as was presented in the drafter for the public hearing, there was $5,000 that was that we kind of joked a little bit about at that public hearing, and we didn't know how far that would go with $5,000 to recruit and retain teachers. So it's been addressed in the other areas of the budget, and if you look in the criteria and standards, the district does make allowances to continue to recruit, and actually we've increased what we think we'll need for next year as far as hiring additional teachers for next year. So I just want to really reassure the board that it certainly is our practice through HR to recruit and retain highly qualified teachers. So it has been addressed in the budget.
Thank you, Ms. Randall. Just procedurally then, when this, the working group of the LCAP that's created, this group continues to be involved in changes, modifications, removing of items or
adding.
When that was changed in the budget, is the working group involved in, or do they know what?
So
thank you.
So after the draft of the LCAP, the executive working group got together and took a look at it, including myself, where I was able to cost out all of the items in the LCAP. So there was a process in which we did remove some things out of it, because the LCAP, in its as presented as a part of public hearing, that LCAP was a wish list LCAP, because it cost over $20 million, every item that was in there. So myself, along with the superintendent and some other committee members, we kind of took a look at it as to what the priorities were based on the community forums, based on the consultations with the teachers and the different things. So we figured out what we could afford in the LCAP, and that's what you see presented today. So as far as coming back to the big core committee, since the time ran out, we didn't really have an opportunity to do that. But like it has been expressed, it is a working document, and we can continue the dialogue and make those changes as seen fit by those core committees.
In addition, I believe that, and I know that I want to say that I remember this. Mr. Taylor had expressed that ACT's desire was that the core people that are part of the core group continue working with the district, as like you said, as early as September if possible, and just keep moving with it. So the same for the continuity's sake and people really being involved with it continue in the process. Correct?
I think that's a great idea. I think we should get started earlier this year, so that would be helpful, so that we don't run, out of time towards the end. But we certainly can do that.
I guess I'll just close by saying it's just sometimes a little maybe shocking. So when for me anyway, we had the draft. I realized that we saw the last time, and for all intents and purposes, we are then maybe would assume that that's what we're going to see here. And if that's not the final one, that at least the group that put it together would be part of the changes that are ultimately made. So then it just, the part maybe that's shocking is that when you get a member from that core group that didn't know that those changes were made and doesn't understand why, and it has to come up during a meeting, just seems would be a little more fair for them to be aware before that why those changes or something was deleted from there. But thank you. And Mr. Taylor, you'd like to make a comment?
I would like to, because it's important to understand that there are two committees working on the LCAP plan. There's the stakeholder group, and you bring in parents, you take students out of class to be part of it, and that's why it is kind of shocking to me that this plan that pretty much reflects what was talked about in that committee with the stakeholders is put up as a public hearing document, and then it's switched with a plan that was put together by what she just referred to as the executive committee, which is made up of the administrators here at Calexico Unified. So without any, when you involve parents and students and you show this is the public document that we're presenting, and then you change it at the last minute when it has to be voted on. It's the same thing that happened last year. But that being said, there was more involvement this year with stakeholders, but it's still not a perfect process. And it's still it's a little bit sketchy, to me when you have, this is the public hearing for a document and then it's significantly different than you vote.
Yeah. And that's where I'm coming from too is if we hold a public hearing, and I think the public is left with the assumption that that's what's going to come out, and then the actual one comes out and it's, you know, different.
Well, we can certainly work on improving the process and making sure that we kind of timeline it out so that we can, you know, involve in the event that there need to be changes, that the draft that appears during the public hearing will actually be very much done when it's brought back for approval at the next meeting. So we'll certainly take incorporate that into our timeline for next year.
Thank you.
Mr. Taylor, when they see your salary, we won't have a problem recruiting. Huh?
Oh, not for now.
Yeah.
No, I understand that. I understand. But it's kind of like, you know, Mr. Calderon Jr., with all due respect, you sat in for about 20 minutes with that group, and, you know, there's meaningful discussions going on, and for the most part, they are reflected in the LCAP, plan, and so I do want to give credit to that. But again, when you're putting something up in a public hearing, if it changes, I mean, it's kind of weird.
I agree. Thank you. And did I hear a motion on this before all of this?
No, I'll motion.
Okay, thank you. There's a motion to approve item I-20 by Trustee Calderon Jr. and a second by Trustee Calderon. And those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-21, the approval of the 2015 through 16 budget adoption.
Good evening, trustees, again. Tonight I'm going to be presenting the 2015-16 adopted budget. Okay, as a part of the adopted budget process, the district has to prepare something called estimated actuals, which is in essence the third interim. What this is, it's the process of updating the current year budget, which is the 14-15 year budget, and estimating how we're going to close the year. We update the revenue, update the categorical revenue and expenditures as to what we believe we're going to spend and revenue that we're going to receive, and we also estimate what we the ending fund balances for both the unrestricted and restricted programs. The projections include our best estimate. So we take a look at our current expenditures to date and project them out through the year end, which are inclusive of salary and benefits, expenditures for materials, and contracts that we have outstanding in the district. Our projected 14-15 totals, the total general fund balance is in excess of $13 million. Unrestricted is in excess of $12 million with $1.1 million in restricted. So those are the components of our ending fund balance. This represents a net decrease of $2.5 million of what was projected at the original adopted budget back in June of 2014. As a part of preparing this document, we use the guidance from the county office, the California Department of Education, school services, and other professionals in the area of school business that provide us with data on updating the budget. As a part of the, so now we're going to talk about the 2015-16 budget, which is the budget you have before you for approval. The district always maintains its best fiscal practices, and we estimate the revenue based on the information from those entities, and that includes gap funding at 53.08%, budgeted changes for statutory benefits, which include our PERS and STRS retirement taxes and those things. Our federal revenues maintained the status quo, so that's how they're budgeted in this year from last year. The district's indirect costs rate for 2015-16, the lottery funds, budgeted based on the school services dartboard. Mandated costs were budgeted based on the allocated amount by the state. K-3 grade span adjustment was budgeted. State categoricals received flat funding in this budget, and one-time discretionary prior year mandates were not budgeted because of the dollar amount, and I'll get into that a little bit.
I have a question.
Sure.
On the LCFF, 3%, is that normal?
No, that is not normal. Initially, we were given projections that it would be about 29% in the 15-16 year, but with the new state adoption, and actually at the time that I built this budget, it was at 53.08%. Well, as of yesterday when the governor signed the budget, it's gone down a little bit to 51 and some change, which will require me to do a 45-day update as well.
51 or 53?
Well, it's 53 based on this budget, but I just received information since the governor signed the budget, so it's going to go down just a little bit. But that's not normal in the grand scheme of things. As far as the LCFF goes, we have eight years at full implementation, but if we continue along the lines of these large percentages of gap funding, then more than likely within 2 years, we're gonna be at full implementation. Okay, and then I guess I'll talk about the one-time discretionary funds. And I did not budget in this budget. School districts were given some one-time discretionary funds, and we received them in the form of Common Core dollars. Well, there was some talk about including them, or this is what you're possibly going to get. But at the time this budget was built, we weren't sure if it was going to be restricted, like in the form of Common Core or anything. So we didn't budget it. And then it went from $180 per ADA to $601 per ADA. So that's a large jump to kind of include in the budget of what I don't know, kind of unknown. So I chose not to budget it until we have more information. Well, I've just been informed today when I met with the county that it's actually gone down a little bit to 500 and some per ADA, and not sure about all the restrictions, if there are any, so probably at the 45-day update, you'll see those changes in the budget.
The funds that we received this past year, do we spend them all?
The Common Core? I believe that we are nearly there.
I thought June 1st was the deadline.
Well, we make exceptions in business for spending, so we can spend all the money. So as long as all of the funds are encumbered prior to June 30th, then we are good. So we're working on it. So I think we're about 90% spent. So there's just a little bit.
Because there were some schools that still had a lot of money.
That is correct. So we are helping them spend their money.
Now,
well, Claudia is helping them spend their
now
money.
Those funds, mm-hmm. Now, those funds are one-time and debt refundable, right?
If we don't spend it, the money goes back to the state of California. So we're working on it. We're helping them spend that money. So it doesn't appear on the pre-list. Yes. And we're going to get it done. We are going to get it done.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, I promise. Claudia, we promise. Okay.
Claudia, Ms. Montaño, tomorrow.
Yeah. I think that was the direction to ensure
yes.
that we spend it.
Yes. That is correct. So there were some sites that had a little bit of difficulty, so we decided to step in and help them even further. So we're going to spend all that money. Okay. Moving on, inclusive in this 15-16 budget in our 1,000s, which are our certificated salaries and benefits, there's some, what's included, there are some migrant program specialist vacancies, there are new positions that are afforded in the LCAP process. It's inclusive of the 6% raise that the district negotiated with ACT for the 14-15 and for the 15-16 year. Step in column is included, and also the cost of living is all inclusive under that object. In the 2000s, that's the classified salaries and benefits, and the very same thing, new positions that are created via the LCAP process, step in column increases, and also cost of living adjustments are included in the 15-16 budget. Under the 3000s, which are the employee benefits, it takes into consideration our excessive workers' comp rate is inclusive, significant increases to PERS and STIRS, our 18.9% increase in our health insurance premiums. Also inclusive are the related benefits that go along with step and column increases, as well as cost of living adjustments. In the 4000s, which are the books and supplies, what's included in that, there are multiple adoptions that are coming forth in the 15-16 year, so the purchasing of those core materials, purchasing of large amounts of supplemental materials, upgrading the technology, as well as maximizing the use of carryover in our categorical programs like our Title I, Title II, and Title III programs. Also, in the 5,000s, which are our services and other operating expenditures included in the budget, are increases in travel and expenditures for professional development. Expenses for our board-approved projects for facilities. Some of those things are included. And those, what that means is what was approved in 14-15, that the work, like summer work and those types of things, those expenditures are included in our 15-16 budget. Capital outlay, the 6,000s. These are expenditures, or it includes expenditures for board-approved facilities projects, and these are items that are $5,000 and above, in addition to work in progress for previously board approved items, and also the purchase of our new vehicles that was approved back in 14-15, and shade structures that are also approved through the LCAP. All those items are budgeted in our 15-16 budget. In the 7,000s, which are our other outgo financing and indirect costs, this is where we pay for our COPS payment, our certificate of participation, and also where we've incorporated the indirect cost to the district for those categorical programs. In the multi-year projection, this is a three-year projection, projecting all the way out through June 30th of 2018. It's a requirement of the state that the district provide a three-year analysis or projections of our financial statements. There is no, on this particular document, which is the adopted budget, there is no certification, like in first and second interim, there is either a positive, qualified, or negative. There is no certification, but this is a good budget, great budget, if I might say so myself. No, I'm kidding. Great budget that encompasses all of the LCAP needs. It encompasses all of the certificated salaries, classified salaries, benefits, and just the general operating expenditures to run the school district. I did want to make a note that in my initial upload of this presentation, after meeting with the county today, I needed to talk about the new transparency requirement, and that's why there's the two little asterisks up there, that school districts now have an obligation to discuss with the board, or to let the board know about the excess in the 3% reserve. So due to the new transparency requirement, the amount of reserve in excess of the state requirement must be substantiated. And in doing so, the district can at this point talk about that additional 10%, because our reserve is approximately 13%. We use our reserves to offset the cost of negotiations, because we are still bargaining with another bargaining unit. We use those reserves, the excess reserves, to cover the facilities needs, as well as general operating expenditures of the district. Never knowing what may or may not arise that's not budgeted for, this is where we tap into to make sure that we can meet the needs or the obligations of the school district. As shown here in this little chart, our ending fund balance for 2016 is over $12 million, and our required reserve is a little over $3 million. So we are meeting our state required 3% reserve in the current year and the two out years. Grade span adjustment. Grade span adjustment, I won't go through all the bullets, but it is being addressed in this budget, and along with the HR department, we are making sure that we're making progress towards the state standard, which I believe in the district we're our requirement this year, I believe, was 25.5 K through 3. So we have met our requirement for the current year, and we intend to staff and to continue to meet progress district-wide. And again, the district does recognize the importance of reducing class size, and we will make sure that we are following the guidelines set in place by CDE. Deficit spending. As mentioned, the district is projecting to deficit spend in 15-16. What deficit spending means is that we're going to tap into that reserve that I mentioned, meaning that our expenditures exceed the revenue that we're receiving in the current year. Again, there are changes, and there may be changes, which I just found out today, there are changes to the gap percentage. As a matter of fact, there's a change in 14-15 to the gap percentage, as well as 15-16, so there may be some changes. And again, this is all based on the governor's budget that was just signed on yesterday. big issue always, cash flow. The district will maintain a positive cash flow at the end of 14-15 as well as in 15-16. So that's always a good thing. And again, we're going to be positive. And again, as I always state in every presentation or narrative, in the event that cash becomes an issue, spending will halt and we will borrow in the form of a trans if necessary. Other funds, these are the other funds that the district operates, Fund 11, which is our adult education. And their total operating budget is approximately $300,000. Our child development fund, Fund 12, is projected at $325,000. We have our cafeteria. They have a lot of money in the cafeteria, and we are operating in the black. So the cafeteria is doing well, and we will continue to follow the spending plan and spend accordingly. Deferred maintenance, our capital facilities fund, county school facilities fund, and our self-insurance fund are also other funds that are operated by the district. My recommendation, since there is no positive certification, I recommend that the board adopt this budget adopt and approve the 2015 budget for Calexico Unified School District. Are there any questions?
We talked about the reserves, mm-hmm. and this is a discussion that we've had before. Reserves are good
mm-hmm.
for a rainy day.
For a rainy day?
For a rainy day, as they say. Have you had any feedback from the state regarding us, well, not only us, but a lot of districts keeping mm-hmm. a larger than usual reserve?
Other than at this point in time, that you have to be transparent about it and discuss it and make sure that it's discussed and noted why we need to have an excess of the 3%. And I think we've had that discussion, like you said, that our operating expenditures, and I'll give you a prime example. I signed our pre-list and our payroll pre-list. And for this month, our payroll was $7 million. Just this one month, and our 3% reserve is only $3 million. So it's really kind of crucial that the district maintain a reserve that's higher than the state requirement.
So in a regular month, just so the audience knows, in a regular month when our just our basic needs, in this case payroll,
mm-hmm.
Needs to be met, if we only kept the 3% reserve, how many months will we be able to survive?
Not one. We couldn't. Payroll this month was $7 million, so our reserve is only $3 million, so we're already $4 million short out of the gate.
So,
mm-hmm.
then we are responsible for not only payroll, but for a lot of
for vendor payments and exactly. all of that. Absolutely, so. You're absolutely right.
Okay, mm-hmm. so I hope the state does look into that. When
me too.
So,
yeah.
That's it.
Thank you. Mm.
Trustees, is there a motion on item I-21?
I move to approve.
It's a motion to approve item I-21 by Trustee Calderon. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Trustee Calderon Jr. And those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Trustees, item I-22 and 23 are employment reports that are discussed in closed session, so I'm going to bypass them. Item I-24 is the approval of a board governance calendar. Trustees, what this calendar would do is guide this board, and more specifically towards the creation of the monthly agendas and what information you and the public would expect to see on a monthly basis on an agenda, and it would serve again as our sort of governing calendar on timelines of what happens during every school year regarding testing, regarding LCAP, regarding reports to the community, etc. And again, also when board members go on to our annual conference. So again, it is just that. It is a calendar that would help govern the direction of the meetings and help us with timelines and help the community, because the community can see us, we would put it on the website so they know what to expect, and maybe will join us. They say, well, maybe everything in December is of interest to me, and they would know what's coming up. Correct. Also helps with, besides guiding the board on the board's self-evaluation. That is correct. If there are no questions, I would motion to approve the item I-24.
Second.
There's a second by Trustee Calderon Jr. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries 4-0. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-25, the adoption of ACT tentative agreement for the year 2014 through 2017. Is there a motion?
Motion to approve.
The motion to approve item I-25. Is there a second?
I'll second.
The second, the motion by Trustee Calderon Jr., second by Trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-26, the approval of Calexico High School Circle Drive asphalt paving. I motion to approve.
I'll second.
The second by Trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-27, the approval of the purchase of 3 new mules from IV Cycle Center for the grounds department.
I have questions on this.
Mr. Nielsen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You know what? I had several questions on it, but let me see. Okay. Which schools don't have a mule?
Currently, I believe Cesar Chavez doesn't have a mule, or neither does Enrique Camarena.
Okay. And the rest do?
Yes, sir.
Okay. My next question is, why are we purchasing 3 instead of 2?
The top one on the quote there is a four by four,
and that's my next question.
Yes, that one would be strictly for athletic fields grooming. The mules that we currently have and these mules that we're asking to purchase don't quite have the horsepower to tow our club cadet, which grooms the infields for the baseball and softball fields. It doesn't have enough power to do a good job in towing that piece of equipment. So
don't we own a tractor or something that we can use?
We do have a tractor. However, when you're trying to make those turns on the infield, a tractor's a little cumbersome to maneuver in those corners. So
okay, because it's like $800 difference in that 4x4, or
yes, sir.
$900, I think. Okay,
Jeremy, we couldn't negotiate that freight and assembly.
Yes.
Expenditure, they wouldn't budge, or
that's a standard charge, and you'll see that with any motorcycle or ATV dealership. I've tried budging with them; they just won't move.
Where'd you go, Honda? Where'd you go?
The IV Cycle Center, and then the only other quote I got was, I believe, from a tractor supply store, which their price was about $1,000 more per unit.
And they don't have a special pricing for schools.
I believe they're giving us the special pricing. You see what the MSRP is versus what they're charging us on that.
Okay. All right. I'll move to approve.
So motion to approve item I-27 by Trustee Calderon. There's a second by Trustee Ortega. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item I-28 is the approval of the Local Educational Agency, or LEA, plan addendum for performance goal number 2. Are there questions? We could have Ms. Montaño come up, or would there be a motion?
I motion to approve.
The motion to approve item I-28.
I'll second.
There's a second. The motion by Trustee Calderon Jr., and there's a second by Trustee Calderon. Those voting in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Those voting in favor are Trustee Calderon Jr., Trustee Calderon, Trustee Ortega, and myself. Item J on our agenda is we're going to reconvene to our earlier closed session. If you are following along on the agenda, you can see item D, items that the board is still going to deliberate. We will reconvene from closed session. Pronto.